Welcome, everyone. Thank you all for being here. Can you hear me okay? So I'm just going to take a couple of minutes to introduce this this evening's event, this program. I'm Heidi Rose. I'm a professor and chair of the communication department, and we have been hosting this exhibition all week, the World Conflict Photography Exhibition, created, curated by the War Zone Freelance Project. And so I want to tell you a little bit about War Zone Freelance and also just say how interesting it's been to have this exhibition here all week long. I introduced the opening last Saturday and said some different words that I kind of want to say now because I've now experienced this here all week long. And it's a remarkable combination of art and politics and journalism and oral history, story and grief. And we've not used this space in this way before. So those of you who are familiar with the communication department studio, it's mostly media production. It's used for media production. It's used for performances, live performances. We haven't used it in this capacity, and it's been kind of haunting and I don't know, just remarkable to have it be open all week long and to just walk, be involved in other things, and then just come in here. And I hope you have a, I mean, I want, you must have a chance to spend some time with each of the photo panels around the room if you haven't done that already. This all came to be because I met O.C. Greenway and Anna Elling as a result of a memorial for a dear family friend, Christopher Allen, whose work is displayed over here. And he was killed in South Sudan when he was embedded with a resistance unit. He was a freelance journalist, and he was only 26 years old. And in hearing about War Zone Freelance Project from O.C. and Anna, and the fact that it had never been exhibited in this country, it had been only exhibited in Europe, I wanted to give them an opportunity to display the work here. So Villanova has the honor of being, you know, basically the site of the North American premiere of this work. And what they do, which again I find really remarkable, is they are freelance journalists themselves. They've got a group of these individuals who have come together to support each other and to create awareness for a larger public, right? For people who either don't understand what freelance journalism is all about, or who somehow take it for granted, or who don't know how complex the daily life is, in particularly in conflict areas. So we're really lucky that they're here to tell some of their story, and I think they're also going to be Skyping in with a colleague somewhere, and I can't remember where, but there will be time for a lot of discussion, a lot of Q&A, and so I think now I just would like to all of us welcome O.C. Greenway and Anna Elling.
To tell you some more about that as well. My name is Anne Elling, and I'm a co-founder of the War Zone Freelance Project, and then I'm a Danish conflict reporter that explains the accent. And this is O.C. Greenway. He is the founder of the project and an American photographer and videographer. So this is called the World Conflict Exhibition, and this is one of several exhibitions that we have for the Warzone Freelance Project. And as you might have time to read in the pamphlet, it is a collection of photography from 11 freelance conflict photographers that covers conflicts all over the world. I think you've had time to look around, but we have over here we have Syria, we have Iraq, we have Bangladesh, Rohingya, El Salvador, Somalia, Libya, we have Colombia, so it's ongoing, and Ukraine. We have ongoing conflicts all over the world that are covered by freelance journalists. And freelance journalism is our main focus to tell you about not only what is journalism, but what does it mean to work as a freelance journalist. And this exhibition has been in various European cities and a lot of universities as well in Europe. To us, it's important to meet and talk to some of you that might have an interest in becoming journalists and in general studies journalism to give a more like real life experience into what this kind of journalism is. And maybe also you will tell a little bit before, as Heidi said, we will meet one of the contributors to the project. His name is Rowan Said. And he's an Iraqi Kurdish fixer and journalist. And he's been very nice to stay up late tonight in northern Iraq and tell you some more about what it's like to be a journalist covering conflicts in your home country and also being a fixer. So we would talk to him a little bit later. And I think we will do some questions when we're done talking in general, but when we're done talking to him, I think we will open up for a couple of questions with you as well, so Roland doesn't have to stay up all night and wait until we are finished.
Hello. Welcome. I just wanted to, first off, thanks to Heidi again for having us. And this has been quite an incredible experience to put these pictures into an exhibition in a communications room, by the way, and see the type of response that these pictures have gotten from people coming in and the audience, and being able to share two memorials from two colleagues that were killed while covering and working in the field. I just, to everybody who's here, I know it seems kind of obvious, but it really blows my mind, and I am a photographer, but all of these pictures, all started with a click from someone's camera from some remote part of the world, and they ended up here in Villanova, and it's really blowing my mind tonight, and I know many of the stories behind these photos because I've worked with these contributors and talked with them and helped organize images together and filmed interviews of these photos. So I know them really, really well. And it's just the amount of work from all of these journalists is unreal. And I hope that these films and tonight will help you maybe look at news in a different way from when you look into a book or see a documentary or whatever. You can kind of see the behind the scenes of what it takes to get some of these stories. But the gentleman that we're bringing on, it's 3 a.m. in Iraq right now, so please give him a warm welcome if you get on. He's an incredible individual. I met when ISIS first started moving through Iraq, and he was one of my first fixers. And then we came back in 15, and 16, and 17, and he slowly progressed into becoming his own, journalist. He's now he's doing really well as an international journalist as well. But like when we first met, he didn't even have body armor, you know, we were just going out and really just putting it together. So this is a little backstory behind freelance journalism. And yeah, so we're going to start with the film for the...
Yeah.
Yep. So we're going to show you a film that we put together with a collection of contributors and their fixers that will kind of hopefully, and if you have any questions after the film, you could jump in, but hopefully we'll kind of bring the story of local journalists as a package deal into your minds to understand where news comes from. And we're talking, you know, anything you watch on TV when it's overseas, even in Europe, you know, if there's something that happens, there's usually somebody on there producing it for that journalist or for that reporter or that photographer or whatever. So here they are. Hope you enjoy it.
What happened in the station today, they didn't ask the foreign journalists anything. All the questions were for me. They said, you are an Iraqi, and when you work walking around with people for foreign people, you should be careful, but because anything happened to them, it's your blame. If they kidnapped, if they were shot, if they anything happened to them, you are the one who's gonna be blamed, and it's possible to go to prison for life for this kind of action. So be careful.
As a fixer, you have to give advice, do politics advice, because you came from the region, you know, the political situation, you know, what's going on the ground. So when you give them advice, that it should be considered as advice. It shouldn't be written in the report under the name of the fixer. Some of them did that. They could, everybody I worked with, I said, please no photo, no name, nothing belong to me, because I don't exist in your report. If I exist in your report, it's me, my family, friends, everybody would be in danger. At minimum, my life would be really in danger. And sadly, it's happened.
My name is Joan, 23 years old. I live in Kurdistan region in North Iraq. When I am not fixing, I study university. I study computer engineering. I started fixing when ISIS came to Iraq and they took over Mosul and they attacked some places near Erbil. At first, it was a good opportunity to go in front line and see the life of IDPs, refugees, and also Peshmerga forces in front line. So that was a main experience. And also, as a student, I want to get money to live and to study at the same time.
I got part of the War Zone freelance exhibition because I think we can show far more people how conflicts impact not only the people here, but our job, how we work together with local journalists and with freelancers and so-called fixers, and how we're even dependent on them to get our stories out.
We were filming and doing our job, and suddenly we heard a yelling from the other building saying stop. So we stopped and they kept sniping us, ordering us to stay in the roof under the sun for like an hour and raising our hand just like this. And we stayed just like an hour. We can't do any sudden movement, because they would shoot us. And I was looking at them and thinking and worrying, because if any mistake happened with his finger, he would be shot at, because the sniper is point on us. And there were two, one on me and one on one, the other one on the photographer. And we stayed for like an hour like this until there was a captain in the Iraqi army, and the writing in his clothes was saying that he is a special force for me. Check my phone, check my ID. All over, because they know that this foreign man they can't do anything for him because he's from Netherlands. He have rights. He have an embassy. If anything happened to him, they will have troubles. But as for me, Iraqi, I have nobody. And they released us. But unfortunately, they deleted everything. But I'm gonna try to recover all those and restore it back.
One of the tough things about freelancing in conflict zones is that you work a lot with local activists or fixers, and afterwards you step in the plane, you fly home and leave them behind. Usually when you work with a fixer you need them because they have all the local knowledge, they have the local context, they know where to go, where not to go, and where it's safe. Sometimes you just have a normal working relationship and at the end of a couple of days you stay by and that was it. But sometimes, especially when you go through situations that are super dangerous or extreme things happen, you really quickly get involved with someone. For one time in Baghdad, I've been arrested with a fixer who got threatened a little bit by the local authorities. And then you know, okay, now my fixer has a problem, and in a couple of days or a week or however long, I will be in the plane flying home, and he will be there, and he might end up in jail or whatever things that they can do without any questions there. They can make people disappear without any problem.
As fixer, you consider how to keep the journalist with you, say, in the same times how to avoid. But the main consideration for me at that time was what is the best way to give the perfect report, full of truth, to show the reality in this place. I was getting open some SMS calls from reaching that they created me that I should stop, otherwise we do that and that and that. And the final threatening, which it was really the worst one, when they sent the soldier to my brother, and they asked my brother, okay, if Rinas, he doesn't care about himself, he should care about his family. And that was the main reason actually I needed to leave the country and to come here.
I started out as a freelance foreign correspondent in Syria in the beginning of 2013. I've been working actually as a journalist already in television in the UK. There's just no way that journalists like me can work in conflict zones without local fixers. It's not even to do with language, you know, even if you can speak the language fluently, the reason why you need a fixer is partly for the local contacts, but a lot for safety and security. So certainly in Syria, it was just impossible. I mean, the amount, even in early 2013, the amount of different rebel groups and checkpoints that you had to pass through to go from the Turkish border to Aleppo, which is a journey that should take about an hour. You know, you needed a local fixer who had contact with all those groups and could get you the right papers and knew how to sweet talk the different groups. So I remember there was one fixer I had who, whenever we were coming up to a checkpoint that he knew was run by a really Islamist group, he would stick Islamist music on the stereo because he was like, okay, this will just get us through, and if they ask, then you tell me you're my wife, okay. The other thing is they can also get into places that we can't get into. You know, even in the early days of the Syrian conflict, the first day I was in Aleppo was when I met Malham Barakat, and I was obviously on the rebel-held side, and he had literally just come back from sneaking into the regime-held side of the city, which is a really dangerous thing for him to do. I mean, he could have been arrested very easily. I'm taken some photos of the regime outside of the city. And that was just fascinating for me as a journalist, because I was on the Rebel Hill side where there was very heavy fighting, there was a lot of destruction, a lot of displacement. It was a really dangerous place. And just a couple of kilometres away, it wasn't just a different city, it was a different world.
A Syrian photographer who took pictures for Reuters on a freelance basis has been killed while covering fighting in Aleppo, activists said. Mohim Barakat died on Friday as he took photographs of a battle over a hospital between rebels and forces loyal to President Bashar al-Assad. As well as covering the conflict, Barakat took pictures showing the life of ordinary Syrians in the divided city, which used to be Syria's commercial hub. The civil war in Syria has claimed the lives of well over 100,000 people since 2011 and driven millions into neighboring countries.
When Mohim was killed, I was in Antakya, which is a Turkish town next to the Syrian border. That's where I was living at the time. It was the end of December, and it was really cold, and I was in the kitchen of my flat cooking dinner. And I got a message from my friend from Aleppo, and he just said, Mohim's been killed. So I called him back, and he told me how it happened. And at first I was actually really angry with Mohim, because the way he died, he'd been photographing a friend of mine. He was working for a news agency at this point and taking really, really good photos. They were appearing in massive newspapers all around the world. But he was on the front line of a battle at a hospital in Aleppo City, and he'd been standing on top of a tank to get a photo, and had been hit by a tank round either directly or by shrapnel, and it killed him instantly. It's just thinking, why did you do that? Why did you take that risk? And then when that subsided, I was just so sad that somebody so young and so talented, you know, was killed so young. I mean, he was only 18 when he died.
So that film basically kind of sums up the experience of not only a producer and fixer who reports on stories and conflicts that break out in their hometown or neighborhoods, but also those who become journalists, like Mohim did as well. Mohim is this board right here on the left. Some phenomenal images from the Syrian war, and like I said before, this is just some dude, you know, a click and a finger, and now they're sitting here in Villanova communication room. It really blows my mind. His images, I mean, I can't forget them. The top right with the white helmets is after a barrel bomb dropped on the city of Aleppo, and his images really told the story of the opposition side of the Syrian civil war. And I think everybody here has heard of the Syrian civil war and how recently you haven't heard much about it. And that's because guys like this have died and a lot of them have fled the country, and there's basically a blackout over Syria right now. Freelance journalists can't get inside of the country. You'll be arrested before you try to get over the border. If you do get in, you're looking at 99% chance of being kidnapped or, killed. So, that was an incredible story of Mohim. His brother was actually a fighter in the FSA. His father was a fighter. And his mother said, I don't want you to fight. You know, do something else. And so he decided, instead of shooting bullets at the Syrian government, he was gonna shoot images. And it was more powerful than taking, you know, an AK-47 and firing some rounds at government troops. I mean, his images were seen all over the world. An incredible feat of, you know, just the perpetual history of what goes on in the Middle East. It's his editor at Reuters, who I know well, was also caught up into a civil war in Lebanon in the 80s and 90s. And his mother also told him as well, you know, as the people came, as the people came to pick him up, the Christian militias, he was a Christian, and they said, "Here, let's go, we need recruits." His mother said, "Put that, give them back this AK-47. Here's your aunt's camera. Go out and photograph the war." So, the issue with Mohammed being so young, his editor was like, you know, "I was 16 when I covered, you know, my first civil war." So, it's just insane. I don't know if you guys are following me on that, but this region is just constantly being destroyed by civil war after, you know, decades and decades and decades. So, and it even reflects in the journalist as well. So, yeah, that's a little bit about Mohem. So up next we have our fixer Rawan Saeed. So we're gonna get him on and have him talk to you guys about what it's like to be a local journalist who covered. Rawan actually covered the battle for Mosul. I don't know, is everybody familiar with the battle for Mosul, right? The current battle to retake the second largest city in Iraq from ISIS. Oh, there you go. Look at that beautiful guy. Look at that champ. Let's give him a warm welcome. Thanks for staying up, buddy. By the way, he just got married, so let's give him another one. Yeah, buddy. Love this guy. All right. So Rawan, if you could, I know it's early there for
you. Yeah.
There we go. That's a little awkward, sorry, man. If you could just kind of run us through, you know, a little bit of what it's like to be a, you know, I remember when you started out in 2014, right?
Yeah.
Covering the situation with ISIS attacking the west of Iraq and also getting close into Erbil. ISIS forces in 2014 and 15 were about 30 minutes away from the capital, 30 minutes away from taking the capital of the Kurdish region, which, I mean, they would say it would never happen, but it was pretty close. So if you could kind of break that down for us, I'd really appreciate it. These are the Villanova students of communications department.
Yeah.
All right, take care.
Okay, great. So first of all, thanks so much for having me on this event. So basically, just go back to 2014. At that time, I was in university. I was studying computer engineering. And then later on, when ISIS was about to attack Erbil, at that time, I was outside the country. So when I came back to Iraq, I could see the development and I could see the change of the demographic, political change in Iraq. So I was studying university and then I had a friend who was working as a fixer at that time, and I was always like interested about like what was going on. So I started my first fixer job, or as a translator, I would say. And basically later on, I just get to know other foreign journalists in based in Erbil, and also international media. So since ever, I kind of been in all the offensive and all the battles that happened for the past 3 years. And so my work as a fixer is to help international journalists, freelance journalists, international media outlets to do stories and help them to basically provide information, a cultural understanding of the situation, political understanding of the situation, of the conflict, and different parties engaging in the war, basically, and also providing security as well and safety for journalists and for everyone. And my job is really hard because you have to be a translator between the people that you interview and also the international media outlets coming to do a story for like a week or let's say or 2 months or so on, and they leave the country. So you have to be like, you have to kind of in a short time put everything in that interview and like try to make the interview happens and like do the story basically.
Can you elaborate a little bit more on the safety part?
So the safety part is really crucial for the point that basically in terms of fixers, related to fixers, most of the fixers in their countries, they don't usually get medical training, for example, because of lack of training in those places and so on. So most of the international journalists and media outlets, when they already have done their kind of medical training and safety environment training as well back in their countries, but the fixers are not, and it's really like rare to have kind of training and also safety training and courses for fixers. But I was really lucky because I remember Ozzy and Anne and those guys in 2015, if I'm not mistaken, or 16, they did a medical training and also safety training in Erbil. And I got really lots of information about the first aid training and also how to save your friend, your colleague, if something happens.
Let me pause you just for a second. But does everybody know what he's talking about? Anybody kind of confused about what he's talking about with the safety? And so basically, like you heard in the Pixar film from the gentleman from Baghdad, when an international comes to Iraq or Lebanon or, you know, these areas, these people are responsible for that individual. So what Rawan's saying is that he has worked to organize the safety around journalists, and by doing that, medical trainings is one of them. So if you're out in the field and you are shot or wounded or, you know, anything like that, a fixer can work on you with his own medical kit, which honestly is pretty rare. This is a new thing, so it's pretty incredible. So with the Mosul offensive, a lot of fixers and local journalists were getting trainings, and we helped out with that with the Wars and Freelance project. Go ahead, Bill.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah, exactly. That was really amazing work. Like you guys did it, and also the people, as far as I know. But that was the only training that I got basically in my whole career for like 3 years, almost until now. Also because as Iraqi, let's say, fixer, you cannot travel outside to get the train as well because of, you know, visa and logistical side of it. So it was really important to do it in Erbil because that was the location basically to do it. And it was easier for local fixers and local journalists to attend it as well. So yeah, this is really important, I would say, as a fixer to take care of the security of everyone, and also other parts, I would say, in terms of logistic and also background information of the story, of the content is really important, because usually most of the international media or international journalists, when they come here, they don't have really enough a cultural understanding or cultural background information. The fixer, usually the fixer is a person who has to introduce that perspective of the place to journalists, and also there are some cultural dogma or norms that has to be addressed before you interview a person or a victim of war, for example, and so on. So yeah, basically that's kind of a brief, I would say.
Yeah, that's really good. Can you describe a little bit about your role bringing a journalist into a conflict area? You know what I mean? Checkpoints and like what is your role? Like what are the physical activities you do?
So my role as a fixer or any other fixer out there doing that job content of, like, for example, would be a normal story or are really in a conflict zone, is to make sure that everyone is safe first. This is really important. And also the fixer has to have lots of contacts in regarding that story. Like fixers without contacts are not really good fixers. because if you have more contact, you're more likely end up with a good report. And also, the fixers have to, my role as a fixer is to provide basically everything for the report before we are going to interview that person, basically. And so it's like basically you provide everything, all the framework to the journalist, and then you go to interview the person, and then later on it's going to be published somewhere on the publication. So my role is really critical, because without my understanding and without my contact or without my translation of the situation, the foreign journalist cannot do the stories, basically. Because it's really hard for international journalists to come to a foreign country and do stories without fixers. So that's one of the perspective of the role of fixers. And also it has a downside of being a fixer as well, and also upside advantage of being a fixer in some cases. And sometimes it might turn really, really horrible. This situation might turn really horrible, and it might end up with a great piece as well.
Rowan, after you started fixing, you've also started to do journalism yourself. Can you try to maybe give an example or explain us like what it is that you can do as a local journalist differently than an international journalist coming to visit your country?
So exactly, yeah. So as a local journalist, so what I did that was before the Mosul offensive, I started to do my own documentary. I started doing documentary in virtual reality, 360 video documentary, and I did one about the Yazidi people and then what happened exactly. And also, I also tried to help other journalists to give them ideas about like stories. For example, there was this interesting thing that happened. I knew a group in Kirkuk. I don't know if Ozzy already talked about the city. Kirkuk is in part of Kurdistan region, also part of Iraq. It's like an oil city of Kirkuk. It's really famous in Iraq. And this city is really like everything is oil, so it's really like a desert, I would say. And there was a heavy metal band in that city. And then I talked this about I talked this to a friend of mine, Campbell. He's a New Zealandian journalist, and he did four stories on them. And he was really always saying like thank you so much for telling me this, because I didn't know this, like that there was a heavy metal band in Kirkuk. So my role, or kind of what I could do as a local fixer or local journalist, first is to give ideas and also to pitch stories to other people and to do it. And what I try to do after 2 years of fixing, I tried to make two documentary, one in Sinjar and also one in Mosul. But for some reason it never published on internet, and then basically I kind of gave up on it, and I came back to fix it, and now I'm fixing nowadays with some journalists in Erbil. So usually the fixers are more likely end up being a journalist by themselves. This is most of the case that happened, because they have the local knowledge and they have the contact, and they know the best way to approach a story, basically.
And you're damn good at it. I acknowledge that. Thanks for coming on. I know you probably want to get back to bed. And once again, congratulations on your marriage, and thank you so much, man. Hold on. Is there any questions for Rowan?
So if you guys have any questions, I'm fine.
We got one up here, but hold on one sec.
Thank you so much for talking to us. I was wondering, why should people who feel as though certain global conflicts do not affect them at home, why should they care about them?
Sorry, I didn't get it exactly.
So why should people in countries unaffected by global, or why they feel as though they're unaffected by global conflicts, why should they care about them?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, yeah, as I think it goes down to the idea of being a human and to feel what other people would happen to them, I would say. For example, what happened in Iraq was really dramatic, and because Ozzy and also Anne witnessed those horror scenes of the Battle of Mosul and what happened for the civilians especially, because they were the target of the airstrike and also the militia, the ISIS militias. And they were stuck in between. And I remember like those days when we were going to the field and documenting the life of Peshmerga, Kurdish forces, and also Iraqi army. And I think they were defending their land, I would say, because they were afraid of ISIS coming to Erbil and rule the city and be under this brutal people. And also they were defending other countries as well to be affected. So I think it's really important to kind of have affection on those people fighting on behalf of other countries to not be affected by these militias and so on.
Yeah, and they had a global reach as well, so.
Yeah, exactly, yeah, exactly. And also, like, I think the Iraqi army and also Peshmerga, without the help of the coalition force, especially the airstrike, they wouldn't really advance as they would do normally without the airstrike. So it was really important to have the global coalition support to defeat ISIS. Unfortunately, it's finished nowadays. But I think the ideology would continue, of course, and there will be another war by another name, I would say, unfortunately, which we will see nowadays in Syria, in Afrin. But I think it's really important to have affection and also to have, like, kind of to feel related to the people, I would say. Because also, like, just related to be a fixer. Fixers are really, I would say, they are really in a critical position because they translate the horror and the impact of those people to journalists, to media, to international media. So, for example, myself, I don't want to interview refugees because every time I interviewed a refugee as a fixer or like a translator refugees, they were crying, and then I had to translate those emotions and those really sad moments. And that, for me, that was really emotional as well, and it's really hard to, like, you know, maintain.
Yeah.
That balance that you have to do as a local journalist or as a journalist, I would say.
Let me check for any more questions. Yep, we got one in the back.
So I was just wondering how often you run into interference with local governments or international governments in trying to set up shoots or interviews. Do you find problems with local authorities interfering with your work?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on the story, basically. It depends on the story. If the story is really sensitive, then you have to work on it really hard, and also you have to do research before. But then regarding other stories, so far, most of the time, I have been, accomplished, I would say. I have been achieved what I wanted. And also, as a fixer, you should have some kind of skill of negotiation and also knowing the right person to talk. But then at the same time, even when you are going to call the right person and get the permission and get everything, there still would be another challenge. And this is where you have to kind of use your local knowledge and your local way of negotiating with those parties or those political factions or those people as well. So it's really important for fixers to speak that language and also to have to have cultural understanding of the content of the story and also for the people as well. So for me, like, I have been kind of well in that way. I have done pretty good job regarding like negotiating with other people and so on. I would say it's a matter of maintaining your balance with other parties. But at the same time, sometimes in some countries, it might get really, really bad on you, because at the end, the foreign journalists are leaving the countries and the fixers are staying in the country. So everything happens after the report came out, then it will be a responsibility of the fixer to bear all the outcome, I would say.
And that's what we pay you for, so that's about it. Now, once again, thank you so much. We're going to have to wrap it up, but thank you so much, everyone. I really appreciate it, man.
Thank you so much.
Much love, man. Much love. Take care, bud. But now, just to kind of, I wanted to jump on the question you had, like, why should we give a shit about what's going on in these other countries? And especially in Iraq, you know, what Rawan was saying was that, you know, ISIS was an international issue that, I mean, I hope y'all haven't forgotten. That was like, you know, a year ago, or, you know, Paris, you know, less than a year, California, whatever. I mean, you guys, they had their cells attacking all over the world, basically. In the Philippines, you know. So in the heart of their nucleus, you have the Kurds, the Iraqis, the Syrian Kurds, the Turkish Kurds, who else? The Lebanese military. I mean, these people are fighting a war that, you know, we as Americans sit in our lazy boy and watch the football game, go Eagles. But, you know, and we don't really notice the war while these people face it and open up their door and it's right outside in the front yard. So you can kind of, in a sense, on the human aspect, the affection of another human, you can see that, you know, they're fighting a war for us. And like he said, without these airstrikes, they would have taken Erbil. Like, ISIS was no fucking joke, man. Like, they were really well trained, and they were 30 minutes away from Erbil, which is the Kurdish city in the north. I don't know if you can imagine a, you know, brutal militia 30 minutes away from Philadelphia, but that's no joke. That's serious stuff. And without the coalition airstrikes, which is, you know, organized by the United States of America, so we got a foot in this game, people. We are a part of it. Our taxpayer money is the bombs dropping on their convoys, et cetera, et cetera. And, we're all a part of this, you know, regardless of the human aspect, we're financially part of it as well. But this is a little side note.
And I think also, like, these conflicts, both the conflict in Iraq, but conflicts in general, can be, if we just see, like, in spot news on CNN when we just scroll through, or in our Twitter really quick, it can seem as something really far away, and it's some different armies fighting, and we don't know these people. But what the conflicts really are, and what this project also is about, that the conflict is so much more, and it really requires time to understand the conflict, both for the audience, but also for the journalists. And this is one of the things, like, all this you see in the exhibition is created by freelance journalists, who we do journalism like all journalists do, but it's a different tasks or grounds that we work on. We're going to show you another video here afterwards that where the photographers in the exhibition explain more about this. But as freelancers, you work independently, you work on your own, which makes you have the opportunity to actually go to countries and stay there for a longer time and take as much time as you need, if you can afford it, if you're able to do it, to really tell the depth of these conflicts. And this is what is so important, and this is also one of the reasons why we really want to support freelance journalism, because we cannot, as an international audience, understand these conflicts if we only see them really fast and just like some photos from the agency and two lines about what this conflict is about. Then it becomes very distant to us when it actually should be something that we should all care about. And this is something that freelancers, both locals and international freelancers, contribute to. And as OC said earlier, that the war in Syria is slowly disappearing from the media because there are not enough journalists there to cover it, and those journalists who are there have a lot of difficulties getting access to actually cover what is going on.
Yeah. And the majority, a lot of the people who cover the Middle East have been barred from going into Turkey. They can't come back. They can't even fly into the country. You know, I mean, it's just like the lockdown that these countries have, just like the question in the back about what is your situation with the government? Do they ever lock down on you? With Rawan, he's in the north, so the Kurdish fixers have to work with two different governments. They have to work with the Iraqi government, and they have to work with the Kurdish government. I mean, like, I don't know if I do this damn job. One time we were... ISIS fired two gas rockets within a mile or so outside of the city limits of Erbil. And a friend of mine who was a videographer was like, I gotta go cover this, because, I mean, it's pretty damn close. So he rushed out there to cover it. We didn't know if it was a gas rocket. You know, we should just hypothetically, you know, he rides out there on his motorcycle and brings a fixer with him. The fixer... these guys come down, he finds a dead cow, no shrapnel wounds, it's just puked up blood. So we think it's chlorine gas, which ISIS was known to use a ton of, and homemade mustard gas. So this was breaking news. I mean, there were still, at that time, there were still oil companies there, and I mean, a lot of money still in Erbil at the time. And the fixer that we used was basically like, I'm out, I can't do this. So he got a cab and went home, because he knew that as soon as he put time into this and did some research in this open field, someone's going to come pick him up. So fixer went home, Jeff stayed, actually this guy on the middle wall over there on the bottom, Jeff stayed and was actually picked up by Kurdish Secret Service, you know, and they, you know, they're very friendly to internationals, but this time there was no joke. I mean, I was on the line with the Dutch embassy, it was a fucking mess, but you know, it depends, like he said, what are you covering? You know, how deep are you going into their stories? And I mean, that's something you have to decide, you know, in your life's on the line when you're making that decision. So, yeah.
And what we do in the War Zone Freelance Project is to support journalists and help journalists to prepare for this kind of work. We do exhibitions as this one, and then we also do, as Rowan talked about, medical safety trainings to train freelance journalists. Often freelance journalists, they start out in the field without having any training, often because taking medical safety trainings can be very, very expensive. Staffers are sent to by their media to take a training, and it can cost thousands of euros to take a training. So what we do is that we do medical safety trainings for freelance journalists. We make them affordable for freelancers and make them accessible in conflict areas. Often one of the things with training is that they're only available, for instance, in the US or in Europe, where the risk of doing a training isn't very high. But what is really important is doing training somewhere like in Iraq, both for the local journalists to have access to them, but also for the free international journalists who are already there to cover the conflict. They're ready to go out and cover it, but they don't have training. That was what we did in Iraq in 2016. We did two medical safety trainings right before the Mosul offensive started. And there were journalists there, freelance journalists, who had come to cover the conflict, but they didn't have any kind of training yet, and the Mosul offensive was extremely dangerous. So we made the trainings available for them in the conflict area. So it's a lot of different projects all to prepare freelance journalists to this work that they do, and then afterwards highlight the importance of the work.
Yeah, I just want to ask, how many people in here are aspiring to do journalism? I'm just trying to get a read here. Oh, all right, we got two. Great, the rest of you can get that. No, I'm just kidding. But now, you know, regardless of where your life takes you, we talk about medical safety trainings. You guys are probably thinking, oh man, you got to be in a war zone to have medical safety trainings. You know, that's not necessarily what we just touched on. I mean, we also do We're going to do a training in the United States as a memorial for a colleague of ours who passed away, and his parents are actually in the audience right now. I just wanted to count them out or point them out. In Philadelphia, because journalism in the United States can also be incredibly dangerous as well. You don't have to be in a conflict zone. You know, if you went to cover, you know, a concert in Las Vegas, it would be really nice to have some medical training and some combat safety training, you know what I mean, that, you know, in the last couple months. So journalism, you know, as a whole is becoming more dangerous, not just in conflict areas, but everywhere. Bringing out a camera on somebody's face can be a big issue. So it's good to know exactly what you're doing when you do it with that camera. Okay. So we are going to show the last video and wrap this up for you guys, and then open it up if you guys have any questions. This video is an accumulation of work from all of the contributors, and it highlights the exhibition, so it's practically another facet of the exhibition. Thank you.
Freelancing gives you a certain kind of freedom which you don't have if you're a staff photographer, for example. You can choose which conflicts you want to cover. You can go again and again in these countries, even if after the conflict is finished. One of the big stories I could do because I was freelancing, I could decide what I wanted to do, was covering Deir ez-Zor in the southeast of Syria with a colleague in the beginning of 2013. It was quite intense, like the most intense experience I had in the Syrian war, because you had like this embattled city, 15,000 civilians still living in the rubbles of it, surrounded by the Syrian army, bombed 24/7. Before the war, it was a place where tourists would go to see the old colonial buildings there from the French time. You had a constant noise of bombs, of shooting in the background, like from the front lines, 3-4 kilometers away. And so you had this echo of war around you, but in the place itself, only rubble and quietness, no birds, no people, you had no sound at all. I got part of the War Zone freelance exhibition because I think we can show far more people how conflicts impact not only the people there, but our job, how we work together with local journalists and with freelancers and so-called fixers, and how we are even dependent on them to get our stories out. If you put the image out of a newspaper, hang it on a wall, and give the viewer time to see it, to really capture the essence in their mind on the photo, you have a far deeper impact, I think, than if the image pops up in the internet on an article for 2 seconds, and they forget it. If it's video, it's shown in the headline news, and then they forget it. If we confront the viewers with these kind of images in an exhibition space, it has a far deeper impact, I think, on them, because they have far more time, it's outside of a news cycle, and they probably will realize better the next time when they open their newspaper what really lies behind that. Of course, I hope also that the audience can realize afterwards, visiting such kind of show how dependent our media nowadays is on freelancers who do the jobs 80% of the time, badly paid, with their own risks, risking their life on the front lines to get the stories out. And we need those stories, not only to be up to date on what is happening, but also to cover conflicts. Like as a freelancer, I can decide where I go, so to cover conflicts which are undercovered. So it shows not only the importance freelancers have in the media business to getting the picture out, the photo out, the text out, but it shows also that without freelancers going to these war zones, there would be like blackness over that country. We see it nowadays with Syria. It's almost impossible to go inside Syria to cover the war because we are targets. It's really hard to cross over the borders. You can only cover certain parts of the country. kind of silence now. Syria, in a part of the war, is off of the radar for large parts of the country because no freelancers can go there anymore and cover it. And there you see the difference freelancers make in war zones to get a story out and to keep it on the radar of the media.
At one point, there was a lot of demand for footage from Mahmur, a small village in northern Iraq, where there was a lot of fighting going on between ISIS and the Peshmerga. And at some point, I got a phone call that there had been a lot of fighting the night before, and they had taken a village, and if I wanted to come take a look. And I thought, well, that's perfect, because there's a lot of demand. But I didn't have an assignment. There was no proper, can you deliver us this and this and this from that area? But I knew I would probably sell it, so I went without an assignment, which is one of the issues of freelancing, because I'm going to risk my life to get the footage that there's a lot of demand for, and maybe I'm not even going to sell it. But anyway, I went with a fixer, Gildette, that I worked with a lot at that time. We drove up to the small town with the commander. There was a lot of ISIS everywhere, there had been a lot of bombs, there was people burned, and arms and legs, and I don't know at all. We stepped into a car to go to the way back. First I stepped into a Humvee, which is a lot safer than the normal pickup trucks that they use there a lot, because it is armor plated, and if you hit a mine, it's no problem. But the guy that was mining me said, come with me. He was a Peshmerga fighter that was sort of responsible for me. And he said, come with me to the pickup. And I was really, ooh, I don't know if I really want to go to the pickup. I prefer to stay in the Humvee. Anyway, the Humvee drove in front of us. We were in the pickup behind it. And on the way back, passing an ISIS town about 1 kilometer away, the Humvee in front of us drove into a mine. And the guy got out of it, or at least the guy that was in the gun turret. And they were wounded, and it was horrible. We put them in our pickup truck, and our pickup truck drove away, and there we were without a car in front of an ISIS town. Anyway, it all went well. We got back. We survived.
This image really sticks out to me, not only because of the subject matter, but the whole stage around this situation was unbelievable. There was mud up to our knees, and in that mud was body matter, and it was unbelievable. It was really unbelievable. And Kurdish soldiers walking around, showing these bodies, you know. And at first I thought maybe they were showing, like, look how strong we are, or which I would understand. But they were more showing it in a way that really affected me, in a way that opened my mind to the humanity that exists within an individual inside of a war. And these people, especially this one soldier I'm thinking of, says, this is a shame, this is a shame. These men come from wealthy, some of the men were European, and they come from wealthy countries. They have lives, they have families, they have a future, you know. And they come here to fight and die in this mud. And you can see on his face, I mean, he was really heartbroken about this. He wasn't doing it just for the cameras. He ended up getting wounded and still says, yeah, I'll fight for my country, but this war is a shame that it has to happen. I was told by several different agencies, it's too graphic, we can't sell it, nothing this graphic. People need to see what the hell is going on there. I mean, that was just one day. Like, there's a real war going on in Iraq still. I don't think there's enough reality to the conflict that these people are fighting to the international community. I don't think they see it.
Go ahead.
Ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
My name name is Christopher Allen. I'm a writer and photojournalist based in Ukraine, focusing on covering conflict. I've worked mostly in the east of Ukraine covering the war there, but I've also worked in Turkey covering the conflict with Kurdish guerrillas in the southeast of the country. So I finished my master's degree in history in 2014, and afterwards the conflict in Ukraine was just beginning, and history felt like it was happening there, and better to be on the front lines of history than to be in the library studying it. And so this is why I came out to Ukraine in the first place, and this is why I'm drawn to working in conflict zones, because it's here where you can really see political processes evolving rapidly and historical developments actually happening. For me, it's been really important in my writing and in my photography to be as close as possible, to engage as closely as possible, to be as close as possible to the war. Not to be, to see it from a distance, to look at it from some, you know, proverbial hill, because like for me it's about feeling what these guys feel, and this is how you get their trust, this is how you really understand what's going on, is to be there with them, to get shelled with them, to get shot at with them. And in this way you see what the war is like, really about, and like only then can you articulate it to everybody else. There's a feeling in these photos of Ukrainian army that these are all conscript soldiers, and certainly they have a different attitude to the volunteers who are fighting with Right Sector. And you can see it in your face, their faces. You can feel it when you're with them. That there's a reluctance, that there's a frustration, and they're not engaged in quite the same way and without the same conviction as these volunteer fighters in Right Sector. And some of these guys are young, early 20s, late teens, and they have other things to do with their lives. I think it's a great thing that Warzone Freelance is using the exhibition as a medium to talk about conflict. I think in terms of how the media understands conflict, how the media talks about conflict, it's quick and superficial. And conflict really deserves more than that. And it's not just how the media covers it, it's the limitations for consumers of media and how they actually engage with it. And for them too, it's quick. It's on their smartphones or on their tablet, and it's an image or, you know, a paragraph, and then they're on to the next article. And this is no way to understand conflict either. I think conflict is emotive. Conflict is messy. Conflict should really be engaged with on some like meaningful level, because it's important, significant. And to do an exhibition, to bring people in, to get to engage with them personally as a photographer, and also for them to engage with the work from across the world dealing with conflict in some meaningful way where they're surrounded by this work and where it's not quick, where they can't move on to the next thing super quickly. It's a great way to articulate conflict and communicate conflict to people across Europe and around the world. On the one hand, it's advantageous to work as a freelancer. You have a lot of freedom in choosing what you cover and choosing how you cover it. You have the time and the space to make a project as you want to make it, and to develop a project as you want to develop it. And for me, like, it's really important to do this work thoroughly, because as much as I see it as media work and news work, it's also some first draft of history. And so, like, as somebody writing and documenting this, it's important to do it correctly. I feel some responsibility to do it correctly. And so to be a freelancer and to have the space to do it correctly is important.
Excellent. I was just thinking about, you know, something to take home from this this whole experience tonight, and you know, this question that this lady asked up here about, you know, why should somebody care? I think it just really stuck to me, and I was watching this film, and I feel like a lot of people come to these exhibitions and they're a little overwhelmed. Some seriously overwhelming shit on these walls, and I feel like it's possible because they feel like they need to do something about it, or they can't do anything about it. And you come and see these pictures from El Salvador, gang violence, it's a war in El Salvador, Colombia, Iraq. I mean, what are you gonna do about it? You know, like what are you gonna join an NGO? I hope that every one of you comes to an exhibition like this and just takes home knowledge. I think that's takes home something that you can understand what another human is going through in another country, and that's good enough. You know, from there, if it blossoms into something else, great. But if not, at least when somebody you meet, let's say you meet somebody from Syria, you have something to say to them. You know, you have an understanding. You could respect them, and I think that's what we hope our audience gets out of this exhibition. This exhibition is unique. This one, you know, it comes to our mind all the time that we may lose a friend and a colleague, and this specific exhibition is a memorial to Christopher Allen. He's the gentleman you saw at the end of that video, who was killed while covering rebel forces in South Sudan. So and it was passing out a piece of paper with one of his images that he photographed, and on the back is the Christopher Allen Legacy Fund. So if you guys have some time and feel like investing into freelance journalism, that's a great start. So they're great people, and we're honored to have their parents and Christopher's girlfriend here tonight. So if you see them, say hello. All right, thank you everyone. Oh, Ben.
I think Chris was an incredible person and an incredible journalist, and I think I speak for everybody in the project when I say that he really articulated some of the things that drive us to do this project and also to do journalism. And I hope afterwards that you would take some time to look at his work and see some of the things that he accomplished.
He really knew how to capture the human, and you could see it in his images. That he, you know, like we did this interview in 2016, and then he went to Sudan, and you know we've exhibited his work before, and he just. All of his images through Ukraine, I mean, you could tell he's actually embedded, he's living with these people, not just as one side or the other side of the conflict, but as humans. So it's a big loss to everybody who cares about what's going on in the world. So thank you so much for having us, and hope you guys enjoy. If you have any questions, now's the time. Same too, these guys. Go ahead.
So my question, something obviously you and Christopher both spoke on in the video, is how we're not getting the right pictures through traditional news media. So where do we find the sources like these pictures in the gallery that news media aren't buying? Where can we go to become the better source?
You're here, buddy. This is ground zero for that type of... you know, these images, we're limited. The full exhibition is over 120 images, and each one of these journalists, you know, has their own flow of media. They produce. Most of them have Twitter feeds. If they're currently covering, so when we were in Iraq, we were constantly updating on Twitter. You know, you can look at, I don't want to keep saying CNN and BBC or whatever, the major news networks, or like you said, where do we find it? You can go look for it. You know what I mean? So we open this up and people come in and they can see Juan Carlos, they can see Andrew McConnell, they can see, you know, everybody on these walls is an individual with his own media company, basically. And anything they cover, they produce on and they share with, you know, either via publications or their own social media. So, I mean, that's one outlet. You know, when I'm following news personally, I go to journalists I know and I look them up. I see what they're doing in that country. I mean, nowadays with social media, we have the access to the individual. You know, it's incredible. Screw the mainstream. You know, but then again, I also know some incredible, you know, staff journalists who do phenomenal work, you know, but you're not going to get that usually, you know. CNN World isn't on everybody's TV, you know what I mean, or, you know what I'm saying.
But I think it's really important to say also that a lot of these, most of these images hanging here have been in traditional media. Freelancers work independently, but they still work for the media. So there are incredible stories out there. I feel like often people come and say, oh, there's nothing in the media, where should I find something of value? But it is out there. But it's not out there for 2 minutes scrolling through breaking news on the TV or quickly through Facebook. Like, it takes time to produce quality journalism, but it definitely takes time as well to absorb it and understand it. It takes time to read the newspaper and buy it and sit down with it. And there are incredible journalists out there, and there are actually a lot of them. And this is some of them and the work that they do, and you can find it out there if you take time for it.
Like, for instance, that image over here, I wouldn't just want any publication throwing it in their magazine. I mean, that image deserves context, you know what I mean? Like, it needs to be presented in a way where people can come and actually learn from it. So it's not some type of, like, you know, bang bang propaganda, you know, war pornish stuff, you know. And we hit a lot on that in our talks wherever we go. So, I mean, you know, if you're looking for, like, I mean, there's so much information in that picture, it's unbelievable, you know. You know, if you look deep into it, there's a lot of information in there. So, for me personally, an exhibition, I've had it exhibited a lot, and we've shared it as well. But this is the type of place you look for, you know, personal photography exhibitions or stuff. They're out there, you know, and we can definitely share some links with you as well. You had a question up here?
How do you capture the human aspect of war or the ideal photo that will convey the message that you want to convey to the viewer?
I think one of the challenges as a journalist is when I covered the Mosul offensive for 9 months in Iraq, and one thing is that it is a war, but actually, as Chris says too, like, war is complicated, and if you just step into it and point your camera and whatever, it can be really hard both for you as a journalist to understand it, but also to explain it to somebody else. And I think one of the very important things as a journalist is to be able to find stories within the conflict, find people who can tell the stories in kind of a miniature format, so it's easier to grasp, because it is complicated and it is complex. And that is one of the things that both photographers and reporters do, that they meet people who, through their own personal story, can tell the more overall story about the conflict. One of the stories that OC and I have been in Iraq was a story about resistance fighters in Iraq. There was a lot of, like, during the war against ISIS, there was a lot of talk about these resistance groups forming inside of Mosul that would, like, civilians who would fight against ISIS. But because you couldn't, as journalists, have access to Mosul under ISIS control, it was really hard to figure out what these groups were like. So as Mosul was liberated, we went around for weeks to try to find some of these people who had fought against the Islamic State in Mosul. And we managed to find several of them that told their story about what kind of life it had been to live under Islamic State and how they fought against them and the importance for them of doing it. And in that way, you took a few, I think you talked to maybe five people who've all been doing this kind of resistance work, and through their story, we told a more overall story about a bigger civilian resistance. But it takes time to find them, it takes time to talk to them and to communicate the story, and then after that it takes time to sit down and read it, to go back to your question. That it's a long process, and that is something that is so important for quality journalism, that we actually are able to take our time to do this work.
And I think with the photography aspect of that is, I mean, there's moments happening all the time, constantly around you 24/7. You know, there's always a moment, and humans are just constantly flushing this out of themselves, these really beautiful moments and facial expressions and whatever. And the key, I guess, in conflict comes with experience, you know, to be able to stay safe and also shut down the rest of the world and look for those moments. You know, I actually have a radar for these situations that come up. You know, like in Iraq, I had these images in my mind that I knew I saw, and I was hunting them, man. Like, I was on the hunt. And there were some times where I saw the image, and, like, for instance, there was a massive attack. ISIS cut off Iraqi special forces and completely shattered them. They lost 40% casualties when they took over the east side of Mosul. It was a hellish fight. And I'm waiting as the troops are getting carried in. We're helping them. You know, we thought they were alive. We're carrying bodies outside of Hummers. You know, we thought they were still alive to help out, and they weren't. And the Iraqi Special Forces are an elite group that are trained by the U.S. Special Forces, so they're not just like irregular infantry. And to be there with them was an incredible honor, you know. And so this one image that I had was, you know, I wanted to show what these men went through. and there was an Iraqi officer who had a veil, like a sniper veil, you know, it's like a mesh veil, kind of looks like mosquito netting, and he had it draped over his head, over his dead friend's body in front of him, and it was the most beautiful image I could ever see. I mean, it told the whole world, you know, what was going on, and this guy just looked up and was like, please don't take my photo. And what are you gonna do? You know, like, that was, you know, these moments, you know, it's not just like, oh, there it is, click, you know, it's like, there's so much into it. There's so much into every shot that every one of these journalists has taken. I know it, I just know these people, and I know that they've done so much hard work to capture these little moments. And that's, you know, that's journalism, you know, is to be able to differentiate when is it okay to pull up that camera and capture these moments, that human element, and when you're gonna get killed for it. You know, I've had situations where I pulled up my cameras and I shouldn't have done it, and ended up putting them throw in the back of a trunk. So, you know, it's an experience, really, that helps you find those moments. Any more questions? Oh, great.
Pictures are so important. How do you find a good one and one that you would trust?
Excuse me? Pictures?
Fixer.
Pictures. Great question. Man, that is a real good question, because they are extremely important. And I hope Rowan, expressed that, you know, how much work he has to do. They're basically your eyes and mouthpiece and ears in a conflict area. You know,
bodyguard,
sometimes bodyguard, but, you know, you're going into these situations on the knowledge you were able to obtain, you know, and who, there's limits to that if you're not a local, you know, you don't speak the language, et cetera, et cetera. And to finding a good fixer, man, because you have to go out and get some beers with them and just kick back. I mean, it's really, really hard. It's, for me personally, it's a trust element. You know, I've had experience before I worked with Rowan, but sensitive here, but I could tell he had a really good heart, and he really wanted to learn and, you know, obtain knowledge on how to be a fixer before he, you know, got into it. And he, I mean, he does fixing for Wall Street Journal, New York Times. He's done incredibly well. I think it's an individual judgment basis. You know, a lot of people, I know, and you've had fixers in Gaza that, I mean, she still talks to because they're such incredible people. And recently, one of our fixers who Anna and I both worked with in West Mosul, who was also like a bodyguard, came to the United States and visited us, which was incredible. You build these relationships, and I guess it's like in any relationship you build, a business relationship, you know, sometimes you take it further and sometimes you don't. But for me, it's a gut feeling. You know, I really got to feel out the person.
And often it's also something that fixers recommended by other journalists who have worked with them. I think I've never worked with a fixer for the first time that I hadn't talked to some other journalist about before. And I think it goes for everybody that in, I think, all conflict areas, there are always like online platforms that journalists come on and say, hi, I'm coming to the country, I need a good fixer, and then people recommend them. That is a big part of it as well.
Yeah, and there's a big difference between doing that as a freelancer and a staffer. Like a staffer would basically come to a country and they'd have on a, you know, a fixer ready for them. You know, this guy we've used before, here he is, this is his rate, da-da-da. It's like set, it's super nice. And freelancers get there and like Anna was saying, is we rely on a community. You know what I mean? Like these online groups are closed only to freelancers covering that conflict. And we're able to share, we know each other. Hey man, this guy's good, or this guy overcharged, this guy, you know, whatever. There's a lot of female fixers as well who covered the battle for Mosul, which was incredible. I've never seen female fixers in Iraq, and they were, you know, several of them popping out of the woodwork, and they were incredible as well. Any more questions? In the back.
I know some people here did a reading to prepare for this event, and something that came up in our reading, it was definitely taking a really critical look at conflict photography, and I was wondering, something you kind of mentioned earlier, how does the aesthetic appeal of photos taken in the midst of conflict detract from or mask the weight of the event itself?
The aesthetic appeal.
Yeah, so like as a photographer, like we're in a gallery space, so we can see it as an art form. And so I was wondering how, like when you're thinking of how a photograph appeals to kind of the artistic side of photography, do you think that furthers our relationship with the conflict as viewers, or do you think it can detract from it? Just as a photographer, I'm wondering about your opinion.
Me personally, you know, I don't call my photography art. I mean, if somebody comes up and says, wow, it's a nice piece of art, great. But I don't get in there to do anything artistic. And I mean, I think you can kind of see that in my photos where, like Juan Carlos in the back there, and he loved the art aspect of photography, and same with Federico over there. I mean, it's really interesting, you know. I think it does play an aspect. I have a colleague who shoots, and what he puts out is art, you know what I mean? And people love him for that, and I'm all for it. I mean, if people are going to see it and go, wow, that's Iraq, look at that art, you know, great. Sounds good. I'm for it. You know, like, I hope that answered your... Yeah, I mean, I ride the fence. You know, if I take something that looks artistic, awesome. You know what I mean? But I hope I really grasped, you know, what's going on in that situation and the people who were a part of it more than the artistic aspect of it. And I think a lot of editors see that in me. You know what I mean? And some of them love it, and some of them are like, I need it more artsy, you know, whatever. It just, it's a give and go, you know.
And I think it's like, I think everybody has their individual idea of how you communicate content and what is a good way of communicating content. I think for all the images in this exhibition, they're incredibly beautiful, but they're also, all of them have information about the conflict in them. And I think since this is journalism, that is definitely the most important thing, that they tell a bigger story, and then you can have your own individual idea of how you do that and what looks good and what is art and what's not art.
Yeah, the image that I pointed to earlier, the pile of dead ISIS bodies, like, you know, some people have looked at that and they're like, wow, this is artistic. And for me, it's very informational. Like, you can see what the men are wearing, you can see how they're equipped, you can see the type of ammunition they have, you can see a lot of the information of how they were killed. So, yeah, I don't know. I prefer information over art, because I think art sucks. So, I'm just kidding, no, art's beautiful. Yeah, you had a question back there?
Yeah. So, specifically with the Kurdish photos in the middle over here, I was wondering, and you had mentioned the local communities surrounding Fixers, with the recent rise of international people going over to fight with Kurdish resistance groups, there's varying degrees of opinion about that. Do you find there's varying degrees of opinion of international photojournalists going over to conflict areas? And as a quick follow-up question, what can an international, like, freelance journalist supply that maybe like a local Fixer can't?
Okay, hold on. Can you dig in on that first question?
Yeah, so my first question relates sort of like to like the Syrian war and
international fighters going over to fight with the Kurds.
Yeah, so there's like varying opinions between the local Kurdish community as to, you know, what role and why do those international fighters want to come over?
Yeah.
Do you find there's like a general like feeling of international photojournalists going over within the local communities? Are they like welcoming of it? Are they critical of it? And sort of what does a photojournalist from a non-conflict country supply that a journalist can in a conflict country?
I think a lot of it has to do with what kind of approach and understanding of the conflict you come with as an international. As Rwanda also said, like, that he have had his work with international journalists that come over and don't really have much of an understanding of what's going on the ground. And then obviously he will be looked at and in a certain way. And I think that is our responsibility as journalists, to come with the respect for the conflict and the culture that we're covering. And I think when we do that, I always meet locals who actually want the story about their countries told. And for refugees as well, if you approach them in a respectful way and explain them what you're doing and don't come over and just stick your microphone in their head and say, yeah, it doesn't hurt.
Which we've seen, by the way.
Which some journalists will do. I think if you do it in a respectful way and take your time, people are interested in telling their story. I think it goes for everybody too. I think if someone came to one of you and with really an honest interest and time to listen, say, hey, I'm very interested in sharing whatever story you might have, I think you would actually be interested in talking as well. But if you come and just want to make it look flashy or you don't really have time, then we're going to look like idiots.
And about the foreign fighters, like, we have done stories on them, you know, I know several of them, and they, I think it, like, for me personally as a photojournalist, international, going into a place like this, it did affect me. I mean, like, you have, there's airports and securities that you have to go through, and I think they would check. They're like, oh, you know. So in the beginning of the conflict with ISIS, I conventionally stuck with blue, you know, blue, but to separate myself, because I, you know, it is body armor, helmets, and, you know, and, I mean, it's pretty obvious when you have like a camera bag and stuff, but you never know, man. And that's another whole story. But toward the end of the conflict, when, I mean, it was just, you're not in a conventional war, you know, I would switch, and I would still think, you know, like, maybe they're going to think I'm an international fighter, or, because it's very easy to get them mixed up, you know. And, but yeah, I mean, a lot of that stuff goes out the window when you're in a war with a group like ISIS. You know, they don't care if they see blue. If they see blue, they're going to shoot at it. You know, it's an international target to them, you know, so.
And I think for your other question about what the difference between what local and international journalists can do, I think there are a lot of access, and as Rowan talked about, knowledge that local journalists can have that international might not have. But I think also as internationals, if we come well prepared and good journalists, I think we as international can sometimes question things that as a local, I mean, you've seen it all the time, or this is, it's kind of in your culture, you don't really question it anymore, where we can come with an outside perspective and look at things that maybe when you've been in the country for a long time, you won't see. And I think that goes actually for internationals as well. If you've been covering, for instance, when I covered the Mosul offensive after 5 months, where we've just been going and going and going, as everything started kind of to become a blur, and you kind of feel like, oh, all these stories are all the same, and then you know that it's time to step out for a bit and take a break, and then when you come back, it's like, oh my God, there's still so much to question here and so much to say. So I think we have that as a benefit or a quality or whatever you can say as an international.
Any other questions?
Oh, go ahead, go ahead.
Thank you. First of all, thank you both so much for bringing all this home to us. That's actually my question. Most of us have not had the opportunity to be in the midst of these conflicts, of these situations. We see it heavily mediated. It passes through many filters before we ever get access to it. And here we have two people who have both been there and covered it and been here and seen what passes for coverage of these kinds of international conflicts. And I guess my question is, what is it that we don't know? What is it that we should be demanding from our media that they're not giving us? What are the resources that we need to respond? And I guess maybe how should we be responding to some of these really challenging images that we're seeing?
I think as an American, when I first came home in like 2013, Jim Foley just got killed. And the news was really big on Iraq and Syria. And it was really, I felt like there was a constant coverage of Syria. It showed stuff. And New York Times, everybody was doing, producing stuff on this conflict. Then I left again. I came back and it was kind of gone, and I'd get calls from my buddies back home. They'd be like, dude, are you still there? Is it even going on? Like, I haven't seen it on the news in months. And I was like, are you kidding me? Like, I just saw like all these, U.S. major news networks come through. Like, where's this stuff getting shown? And I came back and I saw that. I mean, like, on the national news, it's different. On the world news, you might get a little bit more. But I mean, you're, like you said, the censorship and the layers of censorship is fucking incredible. I mean, it's really unbelievable. And really, when it comes down to it, man, it's the responsibility of the viewers, it's the audience, and especially with our tools that we have today, you can find whatever you want, it's due diligence. It's reaching out if you have an interest in and finding these news networks, and like we talked about, like these individuals who have wrote books on the situation, they've dug in deep. And I think getting rid of this idea that you have to do something about it, like letting that go, I think will give you an encouragement into learning more about the humans that surround us, and different situations that are going on in the world. And just like we were saying, being able to speak on a conflict, being able to speak with even a U.S. veteran, so you have an understanding of the war that your brother, your cousin, your sister, your mother, whatever went through. I think it's really on the responsibility of the audience, the viewer, and me as well, everybody.
And I think also as the question earlier, like why should we care about it? I think maybe ask ourselves that question a little more often, both why do we have, both to get an understanding of what is our country doing in international affairs, but also with like the big like refugee influx coming to Europe, but also to the US that we see, like to be able to meet these people, receive these people, and live in a world with them, I think it's important that we know where they come from, in the same way that we hope that when they come to us, that they understand the world that we live in. So I think to sometimes stop up and say, like, why is it actually that I should care about these things and learn about these things?
Especially when politicians are running off of the fear that, you know, I don't know what we're talking about. So, I mean, this is a serious issue. If, you know, I mean, a lot of politics, even with Obama, everybody, you know, we've been talking about these issues and, you know, the Syrian conflict and the FSA. You know how many armed groups there are in Syria? There's 50 or something. I mean, it's so many, and, you know, and no news can cover all 50 and tell, you know, it's so much work. So, it's really a lot going on in the world. So, if I feel like really it comes down to the responsibility of the viewer. But, and also, I mean, like, when you hear a politician talk about this stuff, check it, you know what I mean? Like, is ISIS coming in through refugee? You know, honestly, there's some video up here where we have fighters that are dressed in women's clothing. I've ran past a couple of them. You know what I mean? Now, do they make it all the way up here? I don't know. But, you know, there's ways to dig in. And there's journalists doing stories on this, that exact topic. So, yeah, it's your responsibility, really, you know. Goes for everybody. And I'd like to know if I was in that, you know, what are we missing? It's the details, you know what I mean? And it's really hard because there's this buffer zone of like, do people really give a shit about the details? And that's the key. And I think letting go of the we have to do something about this will maybe open up the peace and the space for you to engage in those details. Yeah, all right. Anybody else, last question. In the back.
Given that you're confronted with so much devastation and humanity, I'm wondering if it ever gets to feel overwhelming or if it just feels like the work you're doing is so important and such a service that that outweighs any feeling of being overwhelmed.
I think, like as I said before, with Iraq, for instance, after I'd been there for whatever it was, let's say 5 months straight, you sometimes get to a point where I guess it's overwhelming, but everything also it kind of becomes a blur, and I think it's your responsibility as a journalist to know when these moments are and then take a break and look at the work that you already did, go back and then find new perspectives and new ideas. And I think definitely, like, we're all these people, photographers are real people. You cannot see all these things and not be affected by it. And then people react to that in many different ways and need to recoup in many different ways. And I think I always talk a lot about, like, the community of journalists. And for that too, it's so important to have colleagues. And as if you work, if you're a staffer for a TV station, for instance, you have your colleagues in the newsroom. As freelancers, we are our own business, but we also work together with each other and are really dependent on it, both for the journalism itself, but also for the evaluation of it afterwards, and talk to each other about what we experience and help each other out when things get tough. I think there are always a lot of questions about whether PTSD and do we have a psychiatrist, and it's very individual, and I think it's also about being mentally ready before you go into these kinds of things and know yourself well enough to say how you will react and what you can do about it. And it's something that we have in the medical safety trainings that we do. The mental health of it is an important aspect as well.
And there's really no way to tackle this kind of thing, you know? I mean, like, you can prepare all you want, but jump in an armored vehicle and 12 suicide car bombs to tell you, you can't prepare for this kind of stuff. You know, I mean, there's no way to prepare for it. So I guess the answer to your question is incredibly overwhelming, you know, and maybe, yeah, I mean, like, it's there's no other way these people are getting their story out. That's about it. You know what I mean? So for the time being, that I feel healthy enough to do it and whatever, I'm going to do it, so, but it is overwhelming, and you need to pace yourself, for sure, so,
And we know we have an exhibition called The Battle for Mosul, and there's a couple guys in there who've been doing it for 30 years. And I'm looking at these guys like, how the fuck do you do it? How do you do it that long, you know, and still maintain? It's incredible. It's really a dedication. It blows my mind because 6-7 years it's a lot. So anybody else?
Okay. All right, everybody.
Tomorrow is the last day of the exhibition. I think, as far as I remember, it starts at 12 to 3, and we will be here as well and packing down at some point. But I hope that if you come up with some questions or something that you would like to ask, please feel free to reach out to us either tomorrow, or we also have a website with emails so you can get in touch. And I think maybe there is some lunch tomorrow. I'm not sure if it's happening, but that we will be here tomorrow. And I hope that if there's something that you find out when you come home that you would have liked to ask, please come on over.
And with the little postcards with the image on it, you know, if you feel like sharing that with somebody, hanging on your refrigerator, keeping it alive, tell that story, tell the story of that image. I mean, that's an ongoing conflict. That's prime time, so. All right.
And we are on social media as well, if you want to follow and see when we do new exhibitions, when we do trainings, and when we're around.
All right, everybody.
And
have a good night. Oh.
Sorry, just one quick. Sorry, Anna, but the lunch thing, it was just for a few journalism students. So sorry, all of you who aren't studying journalism, just forget. So.
And get out. Go.
But please come back tomorrow if you haven't had time to check everything out.
Yeah, well, we're going to stay open, so if you go check out the images and everything. And we'll be here if you have any questions. Have a good night. Thank you for coming.